Good afternoon and hello to everybody. Welcome to today's event, Ask Me Anything, Stay Sharp, Microplanning for Flu and COVID-19 Vaccines. Today is January the 15th. This is the fifth in our series. So if you are new to our programming, welcome and thank you for joining us. If you are existing, thank you for joining us and coming back. My name is Elizabeth Breidenbach. I'm a meeting and event specialist based in the Clinical Affairs Division here at NEC. And I'm pleased to bring you this event along with my division colleague, Sarah Price, Deputy Director of Public Health Integration. Before we get started, I would like to review a few housekeeping announcements. You have joined this online event by either physically calling in or using computer audio. All attendee lines have been muted and will be muted for the duration of this event. The duration of this live event is approximately 30 minutes, including introductions and, of course, a live Q&A. Again, the duration of this event is approximately 30 minutes, including introductions and a live Q&A. Thank you so much for the folks that have submitted questions in advance. We greatly appreciate it. But of course, things pop up as you hear some of this content. So today, the Q&A box will be open. It's open for the duration of this event. It's located in the lower right-hand side of your computer screen. Simply type your question into this box. Ensure that you select to all panelists and just hit send. Again, the Q&A box will be open for the duration of this event. Like I said earlier, we will be asking questions throughout today's sessions to our panelists. If for some reason we need some additional details for your specific question, or if we run out of time, an attempt will be made after the event is complete. At this moment, I also want to remind you some friendly reminders before I turn things over to Sarah. Today's event is being recorded and will be available on the NAC website within 2 to 3 business days. All attendee lines have been muted and will be muted for the duration of this event. The Q&A box is located in the lower right-hand side of your computer screen. Simply type your questions into this box at any time for the duration of this event. And again, if for some odd reason we cannot answer your questions in the time allotted or we need additional resources to answer your questions, we'll either make an attempt after the event is completed or we'll post those into our FAQ document. At this time, I'd like to turn things over to Sarah, who will be introducing today's speakers and be kicking things off for us. Sarah, the floor is yours.
Thank you so much. Welcome back to everybody, as Liz said, who's been following this series. Again, due to popular demand, we added at least three additional sessions. So we're really glad that we are here to hopefully meet that need for you all, and we'll be able to spend a good time talking about all things microplanning for COVID-19 and flu vaccine. As Liz mentioned, the Q&A box is open, so please feel free to start typing in any questions that you have regarding microplanning for COVID-19 or flu vaccine, and we'll get to those. I'll be charging through those, and again, thanks to those who submitted questions ahead of time. We do have two speakers today. I think for those of us who have joined before, we always have Claire Hannon, who is the Executive Director of the Association of Immunization Managers. So she will be joining us in a little bit to theme set and kind of talk about the kind of national strategies around that. But we also have a wonderful opportunity to hear from Anthony Fortenberry, who is a CNO of Callan Lord Health Center in New York City. And so we're actually going to begin with him today. What you're seeing on your screen is actually a screenshot of a New York Times article that Callan Lord was featured in just last week. You may have caught the buzz about New York's strategy to immunize their constituents in New York. And if you've read this article, you may know that Callan Lord was a really big piece in advocating more for patients and trying to widen the distribution of vaccines, especially to New York constituents. We reached out to Callan Lord and to Anthony and said, you know, we would love to hear a little bit about this, you know, what's the difference between last week and this week based on your advocacy work, and then some other really great initiatives in microplanning for COVID-19 that Anthony, along with his other leadership, has been able to do. So next slide, Liz. We'll put Anthony's bio up there while he shares with us for a few minutes on what it's like out there in New York. Anthony?
Hi, thank you so much. I'm really excited to be here and share some of our strategies. You know, vaccine planning and distribution has been such a heavy lift for all health centers, I think. And, you know, I was sharing with Sarah earlier when we spoke, that it is a wonderful problem to have. Having, you know, to try to lift up these vaccine distribution sites and programs with, you know, rapidly changing guidance and relatively short notice to those changing recommendations has been a bit of a challenge for our health centers. But again, it is wonderful to be able to vaccinate patients. And so we're all really happy to have this challenge. A couple strategies that I think it would be great to go into today is, you know, certainly we have very restrictive guidance around vaccination early on at the end of December and earlier this month, and through advocacy have been able to widen that gate so that we can vaccinate more of our patients. But now that we have the ability to do that, one of our biggest challenges is resources and staffing those vaccination clinics. And so, you know, we, in anticipation of that, have been working really closely with our nursing schools. Prior to COVID, we've always hosted nurses from several nursing programs around the city, and it has been a saving grace to be able to utilize both nursing students as well as graduate nurses and recent graduates to build a really robust volunteer program to help maintain our vaccination clinics and ensure we're able to meet the demands of the community now that the eligibility requirements have widened. Another component to vaccination clinics is really reaching our historically marginalized communities that may have a lot of medical mistrust and are less likely to be first in line to sign up for a vaccine appointment. And so we've created what we're calling an education and engagement committee that is really focused on both steering our operations to ensure that we are being as equitable as possible around vaccine distribution access, as well as doing really targeted outreach to communities that we feel have historically had a lot of medical mistrust. And so we're partnering with community organizations that we know serve those communities and that we've worked with historically, and building promotional materials to create a really robust campaign to ensure that all of our operations are not just serving those that would, you know, generally be first in line for vaccination, but also reaching those that we think would be less likely. And so to really, I think, both making sure that we have an equitable distribution to the patients that are coming in the door and ensuring that we have enough access through staffing.
Excellent. Thank you so much, Anthony, for sharing those. Those are, you know, two areas we haven't talked too much, actually, about on these series yet. So I'm so glad to be able to focus on those two areas. If anyone has specific questions for Anthony about either of those initiatives, please feel free to put them in the chat as we're going. I'm going to pivot over to Claire Hannon with the Association of Immunization Managers. Claire, there's been a lot going on actually overnight and over the last week. So we'd just love to hear. You always give us just kind of an overview of the landscape of all things distribution and programs. So feel free to take it away. Thanks for joining us, Claire.
Yeah, sure. Thanks a lot, Sarah. And I mean, it is crazy. It does seem like things are changing by the hour, so we're trying to stay on top of everything that's happening. I think in a nutshell, you know, states are working to expand out from phase 1A, so opening up to seniors either 75 and older or 65 and over. You know, doing that, we always knew that this would happen at a different pace in different states, but we are seeing, you know, nearly every state going to that. I think we tried to check to see where states are. We did a quick survey, and we didn't get a lot of responses, but 90% were expanding out to older Americans, mostly those over 65. So I would say that, you know, the allocations are not increasing. You know, the production's not going like this. It's still going like this. So we're just going to be fighting with that situation of having high demand and still having limited supply. So states are really looking at ways, and it's really coming down, you know, falling to the local counties and health departments as well to really manage that demand and to have systems in place for scheduling and for making the vaccine available to those older than 65 with just the limited doses they have. So there was also, let's see what else is happening this week. There was a press conference from the Operation Warp Speed folks on Tuesday, encouraging that states open up, vaccinate those over 65 and also those under 65 with underlying conditions. I think that, you know, those that population is very, very large, and without additional allocations, it's very difficult to do that. So we've seen a few states put on their website that, you know, they'll be doing that, but we haven't had a chance to talk with states to see how that might happen. And I think most states are, you know, still very conservatively opening just for those over 65 and making sure they have, trying to make sure they have some system in place to manage that demand. Another thing that was discussed in the Operation Warp Speed press conference, and this was also an announcement by President Biden-elect, was that they wouldn't be holding second doses back any longer, and that they would be making those doses available. I think states got really excited to hear that, thinking their allocation would increase, but the allocations did not increase. So this week's allocations were still, you know, the same as they have been for the past few weeks, pretty consistently. You know, they might range up and down a slight amount, but it's really been consistent over the last several weeks, and it's not increasing. And I think we're trying to understand what that means. And I think what Operation Warp Speed is saying is that, you know, we didn't actually physically set aside second doses that now we can release. We had some amount in reserve and we're going to release that, but it's not a large amount. We really had set aside second doses in the virtual queue. And I don't think that will change, because I think, you know, the doses need to be available for giving second doses. So the concept was never to not give second doses. It was always just to not have those second doses sit on the shelf. And if they really weren't sitting on a shelf, if they were just sitting in a virtual queue, then it's not resulting in additional allocation. And I know that that's the name of the game right now, right? Every state needs more allocation. And, you know, there's been a lot of talk about what's happening with all these doses and, you know, that are showing as not being administered in the COVID tracker. And I just want to emphasize that the COVID tracker, it's great to have that transparent information out there, but it's hard to use that as a measurement of how we're doing. You know, again, I think maybe perhaps 70% is absolute success on the COVID tracker, because about 30% is being shipped 1 week that won't be, you know, administered until the next week. So we're always going to be that 30% or so behind. And, you know, that's important. We don't want really to be at 100%, because that would mean that production stopped and we had no shipments in 1 week that allowed us to administer 100% of our doses. So that's just something to keep in mind. And then I would just say that I see that, you know, there's sort of three buckets where vaccine is going: the long-term care facility program, hospitals, and then all the other providers, including, you know, community health centers or local health departments, wherever it may be going. And so states are really trying to look at those three buckets and determine, you know, where there might be challenges and what they can do. The long-term care facility program, of course, is with CVS and Walgreens. And I think they are increasing, you know, their output. But what kind of challenges they're having, it's hard. We haven't had real direct conversation with them. But that's a challenging group to work with. And then the hospitals and local health departments, from what we hear from our members, is that, you know, they're giving out doses and they're crying out for more doses. So we don't quite understand what's going on there. You know, there could be some lag in reporting. There could be other things. We're really talking with our members to try to find out. But it is vaccines going into arms. It will continue to be vaccines going into arms. You know, many states looking at, you know, using more large scale clinics. So we should see that happening. And then we should see funding coming out. We should see the funding getting into the states hopefully next week. And again, then we have this big commitment from President-elect Biden. We don't have a lot of information on what he's saying, but obviously he's committing or saying $20 billion he wants to invest in this, and he wants to use as many sites as possible, all hands on deck. He's also investing in the production, you know, calling in the Defense Production Act to increase production. So, you know, these are all good things. We don't know exactly what they mean, but, you know, just to report, vaccines going into arms, good, and hopefully that's increasing every week we go.
Excellent. Thank you so much, Claire. So much going on, and this is, again, why we like to have these weekly sessions, because so much happens this week. By this time next week, we'll also have a new president, so who knows what we'll talk about then.
Yeah.
Brace yourselves. Make sure you register for next week's session. I want to start the questions. Actually, it's a question for both of you, and I think you could answer it differently. So we'll start with Anthony to answer this question. What is a positive model of interaction between you and either your local or state health department when it comes to communication about the COVID-19 vaccine? You know, what have you seen at your own health center about how to enhance or have a positive interaction as it relates to that vaccine?
Well, I will say that we have almost daily communications with our city Department of Health around both access to vaccine, but also sharing best practices. So something that they've set up is a daily survey where we can share new challenges that have come up, you know, in the last 24 hours, as well as new strategies that we're implementing and utilizing that they can then share with other health centers. And I think the City Department of Health kind of being that coordinator of best practices has been really helpful. We've been able to share our challenges and also learn from other health centers' experiences.
Excellent. And Claire, from your lens, obviously you work with the immunization manager on the other end. Is there any kind of example of where you've seen those immunization managers work really well with community immunizers?
I mean, I think that is the best practice, right? What Anthony just talked about in New York. So I would say that some states maybe don't have that capacity to have that going on a daily basis, but we are encouraging them to, and that's definitely the best practice, is to have transparency, you know, open back and forth, so you know what to expect. And then, of course, if there are any best practices, and if anyone needs help trying to set that communication up, you know, we try to help with that.
Great. Excellent. One question came in specifically for Anthony, but I think this is a interesting thing to talk about even more broadly about public-facing resources and materials on the efforts that you're doing. So I know, again, Anthony, you talked about the DEI work that you're doing with this. You and I offline had also talked about a QI initiative that you're doing. So it's not just, you know, giving COVID and getting it done, but you're actually, investing in some QI work around that. Are there any, you know, specific resources that either you're using or that you think you might be publishing out for the world to see or use?
Well, you know, I've been saying a lot lately that we are building the plane as we're flying it. And so it is hard to, like, simultaneously come up with these models and then publish resources around them. That being said, the New York State Department of Health has come up with great resources to help ensure that your volunteer workforce is well-trained specific to COVID vaccination. And so there are some resources on the New York State website related to just building out a competency program for your volunteers, which I think is super helpful. As for the DEI component and undoing medical mistrust or addressing medical mistrust within certain communities, there isn't a lot of literature outside of specific medical mistrust related to HIV care, of which there is a ton of research, and a lot of it is transferable or relatable to COVID vaccination as well. And so that's where I personally found a lot of research and resources that is, again, specific to HIV, but I think really does speak to the same issues of medical mistrust and engaging people in care that we've been managing over the years. In relation to the QI specifically, we are using pre-visit planning and trying to ensure that so many of these patients, particularly over 75, we've encouraged not to come into the health center for the past year. So they need a blood pressure. They need perhaps additional labs that hadn't been drawn over a period of the last 6 to 9 months. And so we're taking the opportunity, if we have them in the clinic for vaccination, to try to do as much care gap closure as possible. And of course, if you're struggling with resources financially, it also does create opportunity for a full primary care visit to happen at that point of vaccination. So we're using pre-visit planning to kind of pull those patients out of our vaccine schedule that we think might be most appropriate for a more robust visit. And then we're having a medical provider oversee the sessions and create that appointment.
Excellent. And I will share, I have a slide on this later as well, but I will share that NAC has a COVID-19 website that we are constantly updating. So if you're out there and you're looking for some resources, we are trying to kind of collate and gather and share a lot of those resources as well, you know, what we see useful. But, you know, agree, Anthony, I was, I'm going to be a vaccinator myself in D.C. As a volunteer. And so I was directed by to DC's Department of Health website for my training. So it's great. I think a lot of states are doing that just to at least get that that bare minimum training. And then beyond that, we see a lot of health centers developing tools of their own that actually really fit their community and their population as well. Excellent. I think we have time for maybe one other question, and it's around funding. I don't know that either of you can fully answer this question, but I'm just curious your take on it. You know, it's been found that, you know, while the vaccine and the supplies such as needles and all are given, you know, freely, obviously, to immunizers, there's a lot of talk right now about funding for those other things, like people time and other resources. So I wonder if either of you can talk about, you know, what kind of the conversations are going on in your shops about funding and your need and how you kind of see advocating for the funding for those extra things. Claire, do you want to start?
Yeah, I can start from the top level overview. There's $3 billion in funding coming to the 64 awardee jurisdictions, so the 50 states, 8 territories and federated states, and then 6 large cities. That $3 billion is coming hopefully next week. They will have 45 days to put in a plan, you know, for how they're going to be using that funding. Our members say that staffing is high on the list. But as far as how the funding gets, you know, to locals and community health centers, you know, I think that has to be mapped out in those 45 days. So, you know, it's really important to communicate up the needs as well.
Great. And Anthony?
Yeah, so for us, you know, certainly I think the Quality Improvement Initiative is helping to generate some revenue and, of course, do some care gap closure and improve our quality metrics and health outcomes. So it's kind of a win-win that is helping us to, I think, over time, create some, if not break even, but some revenue from these vaccine sessions. Outside of that, I think that was a lot of the impetus for the volunteer workforce. Of course, even hiring people right now would take time to process and get them going. So a volunteer workforce has been another strategy that we are using to address the lack of financial resources. You know, I think so many health centers are going into 2021 not on strong financial footing after a long year of COVID. And so I think leaning on community resources like volunteers, trying to think of creative strategies where you can generate billable visits while you have people in your health center that may otherwise have not been coming in over the past year are two really important strategies until we can get the funding that will allow us to really scale up this vaccine initiative to what we think it needs to be. This is not going to be a short term. I think we're going to be vaccinating people well into this year. And so we're also trying hard to be cognizant of nursing burnout. you know, we've been leaning on these same nursing staff a lot for overtime over the past year. And now that the vaccine clinics are up and running, we're leaning on them even more. And so being really thoughtful about that has been top of mind for me as well.
Excellent. Thank you. We got one last question, and I think you kind of already touched on it, Anthony, but the question is, do you recommend just having a vaccine clinic or combining the vaccine administration with a primary care visit? You just spoke to this about, you know, it kind of depends, right? And anything else to add to the answer or Claire as well?
Well, I will just say that it does require pre-visit planning and some chart review to be able to determine which patients might be most appropriate for a primary care visit. We are doing them simultaneously. So we have a full session of, you know, quick vaccines to get as many as we can done as quickly as we can. And then we have an adjoining primary care session where we're pulling patients out into full, robust primary care visits as needed. And so for us, I think the answer is both simultaneously.
Yeah, and I would just say to have a plan, you know, to be able to scale up, to know what your throughput is for vaccinating, you know, like he mentioned, doing things both, but having them separate so that you can, if need be, scale up when additional, when hopefully, you know, more supply comes.
Yeah, great. And then very last question. Do you see that this vaccination, do you think it's going to be an annual requirement? Is this now going to be on the new schedule? And if you want to defer, that's okay too. Not to put you on the spot, but what are your thoughts?
Yeah, that's a good question. I guess I'm hopeful that it's going to have long lasting duration, the protection. So I'm hoping that it won't be an annual vaccine, but I think it will be incorporated into the routine schedule.
Yeah, that's what I would say. Excellent. Well, that is all the time we have for questions. I want to get to just a few closing things. First of all, I want to very much thank Anthony and Claire for today's Ask Me Anything. You all really gave us some great ideas, a good lay of the land, and you know, good strides for moving forward. So I want to thank you so much for your time. If there are any additional questions for them from our attendees, feel free to email me, and I'll be sure to get those directly to both Claire or Anthony as well. So first of all, thank you so much.
Sure.
And then, great. And then, Liz, if you can move to the next slide. Perfect. I want to let you know about a new tool that was developed with community health centers in mind. As I alluded to, NAC has a COVID-19 website, so this is actually just put up on there. It's a two-page that kind of runs through the different core components of microplanning for COVID-19 vaccine delivery in health centers. And so we compiled all of the things that we're learning from health centers and really just try to make it applicable. So if you are at a health center and you're kind of like struggling to kind of get the whole picture in mind, this may be a great tool. This is great for people in leadership, or also just to kind of explain the intricacies of microplanning. So we hope that you will access that on our website. The link is below, but if you just go onto our next website, nachc.org, and click on COVID-19, this is posted there. So we hope that you find that useful. And there's a lot of other resources up there as well. And then next, again, we have at least two more sessions. Next Friday, we'll be hearing from Holyoke Health Center. They are doing a huge pharmacy-run initiative around COVID-19 vaccine. They've also created a bunch of different staff-facing education materials to increase staff uptake of COVID-19, as well as a lot of other workflows and screening questionnaires. So they'll be sharing those with us on next Friday. So we hope you come back for that. The whole pharmacy team will be on that. If you haven't registered for that one, you can lift up your phone right now and scan that QR code that's on your screen and be able to attend that. And then finally, We just want to thank you again for everything that you all are doing. We thank you for the time that you spent with us today. Please feel free, again, to reach out to NAC. My email is fprice@nachd.org. If you have any questions or well, any follow-up on these sessions, feel free to reach out. And again, I can triage those. But we hope that each of you continue to stay strong, stay healthy, and we look forward to seeing you on the webinar next week. Thank you. And again, thanks to Anthony and Claire.
Thank you so much.